paranormal. Baby. That cannot be explained by scientific methods.
Told of a creature that was 6.5 to 7 feet tall.
The CIA ran secret mind control experiments.
It's a tale of a creature that's been seen by many, but believed by few.
And experts say there have been reported sightings of paranormal activity.
And there was this creature, and it ran down this hill.
They say something was flying over their house, and they have no idea what it was.
How the world's most powerful individuals are actually shape-shifting reptilians.
My scariest ghost hunting experience.
Jason and JV.
Jason and JV.
Jason and JV.
You want answers? I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle
you
the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
Quit it now!
Beyond reality. Radio.
It's Monday on the West, Tuesday on the East. Many are stuck somewhere in between. Welcome to Beyond Reality Radio with myself, Jason Hawes, and the always awesome JV Johnson.
For a minute there, I was like, where's that voice coming from? Who is that strange
voice? Where's that
voice
heavenly voice?
I haven't heard in a week. That's good to have you back, my friend.
It's good to be back, man. Yeah, I've missed you.
Yeah, it's been a strange way. Let's not get into that.
Yeah.
But we have a great show tonight. We're going to talk about some cool stuff.
Yes, we are.
We've got Dr. Ken Hansen, who's a Judaica professor. He's going to be talking about the Dead Sea Scrolls, also the mysterious Copper Scroll, which was one of the Dead Sea Scrolls. In addition to that, we're going to talk about paranormal experiences of an ancient priestly class, interdimensional beings, mysteries of biblical archaeology, and has the Ark of the Covenant survived history and time?
That sounds like it's stuff right up our alley.
It is right up our alley, and it sounds like the stuff of an Indiana Jones movie.
It really does. Yeah, when I was reading it, I was like, oh my gosh, yeah, it's like Indiana Jones right out of it.
And in fact, Dr. Ken Hansen's nickname is Jerusalem Jones.
That's different.
So he's got a little of the Jones thing going there, too. And he, if you look at his website, which we'll talk about a little bit later, he actually wears the fedora and a leather jacket, very much like Indiana Jones.
Is so he I can scared see of snakes?
That I don't know. We're going to have to ask him. We're going to have to ask him that. It had to be snakes. It had to be snakes.
Hey, if you haven't yet, make sure you head over to Facebook.com/Beyond Reality Radio. Like the Facebook page for us. Then head to BeyondRealityRadio.com, where you can find all the stations we air on across the country. You can also download the free smartphone apps, which allows you to listen live, catch past shows, join the online chat, and more. Or just anytime you want, listen right from the website when we're live, just by clicking the Listen Live tab in the upper right-hand corner. And you can also connect into an online chat room, hang out with a bunch of great people, and so forth. If you download the show from iTunes or anywhere else, do us a favor and rate it for us, because it helps push it forward and makes it easier for people to find.
Yeah, it's a great community of people to be involved with if you join the chat and keep track of what we're doing on social media. Then you'll know things like on Wednesday night tonight, we've got Mark Stavish coming on. He is going to talk about the occult entities that watch over human destiny. They're known as the egregores.
Really?
Yeah, that's what they're known as.
Okay. And then Thursday, we'll be talking to Tito Abeo, a reincarnation specialist. Tito will be talking about his new book, The Monograph of the Parallel Life, which centers around reincarnation experiences and training.
Yeah, some good stuff coming up. Did you see that video that's gone viral? It's been circulating all over the internet of what looks to be like a man walking through the clouds.
No.
We're going to have Slick put that up.
Where was this?
I totally missed it. It was sent to me. I watched it, and it is pretty spectacular. If it's legitimate, it's pretty spectacular. Some people think it's an image of God walking across the sky. And it is, it's subtle, and you have to watch it a couple times before you see it. But eventually you can see it. And I'm hoping that Slick can put it up on our Facebook page so that people can go to the Beyond Reality Radio Facebook page and take a look at it, because it's pretty cool.
That does sound interesting. It's something I definitely got to check out. What did you end up doing over the weekend?
I did a lot of cleaning, catching up, organizing. As I think I've told you, well, you know this, but I think I mentioned it on the air that I've had some computer problems here in the studio. So I did a complete...
Well, that's because you use Windows.
It's true. I'm not going to deny that.
I don't have any problems on a Mac.
But I did a computer swap out, which turned into quite a larger project than it ever should be, but that's again the nature of Windows. And you know when you plug a computer in, you should be able to turn it on and start working on it. I plugged this computer in and it took like 8 hours for this thing to do all its updates and all its, you know, it was a brand new computer, all its everything. And I'm like, I have other things, and you know, you don't know how long it's going to take, so you're sitting there, you know, and then you just, anyway, enough of my problems. But I spent a good deal of time this weekend doing that.
Well, Satori, my youngest daughter, I should say, decided she wanted to go out and do some investigations with the TAPS team. So she went out there, and they were doing a fundraiser in Connecticut for breast cancer and things like that. So and it was at this antique shop. So and they had sold it out. Well, randomly, I just showed up with everybody there. It was great.
Oh, that's
so
neat.
All these fans of Ghost Hunters were just like. They had no idea. I just knocked on the door. I walked in and they were there. So I hung out with them for a little while. It was a good time, but, yeah, I mean, it's one of those things that I like seeing this is my third daughter that's been involved in the paranormal, who's highly interested in it. And, so now she really wants to get involved. She wants to go on a bunch of cases and then my boys, we'll see how many of them out of the three jump into the field.
Well, out of the three that you admit to right now.
Right, exactly. But it's funny, Satori goes, she says to me, she's like, Dad, this is like 2 weeks ago. She's like, do you think if I put in an application that they'd accept me in TAPS?
I think she's got a leg up.
I guess, Tori, maybe just see what happens. So
I think she's got a leg up. I think she's in good shape.
Hey, did you hear about, there's a bunch of weird things that have been going on in the news. First off, you know that British UFO hunter who ended up passing away mysteriously, Max Spears, 39-year-old, the one that they found his body.
Was he in Berlin or something?
Yeah, Poland.
Poland, right. Yeah.
And he had vomited like 2 liters of black blood before he died.
Right.
But now there's all this weird stuff going on with it where I guess his laptop was totally wiped before it was given back to the family.
And to quote Hillary Clinton, you mean like with a cloth?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, with a cloth. Okay, it was just cleaned curious. All up yeah. and everything else. Yeah. But no, so, and the story just talks about how that was clean, that was wiped. Yeah, his cell phone, some weird things with his phone had gone on. But in December 2016, the court heard the conspiracy theorist about him vomiting blood before he died and all that other stuff. The dad of two had allegedly made many enemies in his investigations. Authorities in Poland, where Mr. Spears was attending a conference, initially concluded the sudden death was due to natural causes. A message from his phone sent to his mother, Vanessa Bates, before he died, warned, "Your boy's in trouble. If anything happens to me, investigate." Well, I guess there's this pre-inquest going on, and part of it went on yesterday. And the court heard from the spokesman for Max's mom, Adam Taylor, call for members of the Polish emergency services and so forth to appear as witnesses. But yeah, this a lot of weird things are coming out now because, again, his laptop was all wiped clean and there's been things done to his phone. And they're trying to understand why, even because his death is mysterious enough. And him sending text messages to his mom saying that he's in trouble.
Yeah,
you wonder.
Did you mention it was a year ago or so that he actually died? Right, this has been going on for a while.
Yeah, it was. I think it was over a year. But yeah,
it was over a year.
You know, yeah. It's scary, and hopefully there'll eventually be some answers that come out of this.
Yeah, there's been a lot of mystery surrounding this whole thing, and of course, having him pass away in Poland doesn't make it any easier when you have those international borders to deal with. That makes everything far more difficult to get answers. But that's something that there needs to be some answers.
Yeah, there really does. And of course, with a lot of the things he was involved in, he made some serious enemies, but it opens up this whole can of worms and really starts getting a little spooky when you find out about the things like his laptop being pretty much cleared of all the data and things like that. It makes you wonder why.
Yeah, we'll have to keep an eye on that story. By the way, Slick did get the video of the image walking through the sky on the Beyond Reality Radio Facebook page. If you haven't seen it, check that out because it's pretty darn interesting. I'm curious as to what you think, if you think it's a fake or if it's something legitimate.
I'm going to check that out during break. And that's facebook.com/beyondrealityradio. Again, facebook.com/beyondrealityradio.
All right, so we're going to take a break, and when we come back, we'll bring Dr. Ken Hansen into the program. We'll start talking about the Dead Sea Scrolls.
All right, you listen to Jason and JV, Beyond Reality Radio. We'll be back after this.
Baby, out of value disease. Yeah, you may have all you want.
Welcome back to the show. It's Beyond Reality Radio. Jason Hawes, JV Johnson. We're so happy that you're with us tonight. Did you get a chance to look at that video?
I did.
What'd you think?
I did. It's really. I don't know, but the problem is this day and age, so much can be done with programs like Adobe After Effects and things like that. So it has me a little worried.
And despite the fact that almost everything is true that you read on the internet, sometimes you have to be a little cautious, I think, right?
You have to be extremely cautious.
Yeah. All right. Let's bring our guest in the program. Tonight we're talking with Dr. Ken Hansen. He is an author and a researcher. His books include The Dead Sea Scrolls, The Untold Story, and his website is treasuresintime.org. Ken, welcome to Beyond Reality Radio. It's great to have you on our program tonight.
Good to be with you from the University of Central Florida, Orlando.
Yeah, that's a great place to be. So
it is a great place to be. It is a great place. Let's talk about how you got your start. Where did you develop your interest in these topics, and how did you get started on it professionally?
Yeah, well, a long and winding road, I got to say. I grew up in the suburbs of Chicago, normal enough kid, went to the University of Illinois, studied history, pre-law curriculum, going to be a lawyer. When it dawned on me, I got to say, one fine day, you know, it could just be the world has enough lawyers. Honestly, I had that thought.
Well, we appreciate you thinking that.
Yeah, exactly. And I thought to myself, well, okay, it's a miserable field. If I really am not cut out to be a lawyer, what am I going to do with a history degree? It's a problem. And our professors were always telling us, hey, you got to zoom in, narrow your focus on one particular aspect of history. It's a broad tapestry, the whole of world history. Well, what's your focus? And I just let my intellectual curiosity take me where it wanted to go. And I wanted to go back to the very seedbed of Western civilization and Western thought and culture. And if you're on that road, it's going to lead you back to the ancient Near East. That's where it all began. We're talking about the ancient civilizations of Egypt and Mesopotamia, and smack in the middle, right hugging the eastern flank of the Mediterranean Sea, was this ancient land called the Land of Israel. And I was really interested in the back and forth interplay between ancient civilizations, and that was the most seminal place where everything seemed to gel and come together and gave birth to cultures and cultures of the West, especially Judaism, Christianity, Islam. So I hopped on an eastbound plane for Tel Aviv, still a senior in college, never before been out of the United States. Except a single afternoon in Tijuana.
We've all done that trip.
And plunked myself down in the Middle East. And it's in the middle of an entire culture, sights, sounds, food, everything totally foreign to me. It was just massive, massive culture shock. Almost bailed out, went home, but I'd come halfway around the world to study. I enrolled in a little nondescript school for Americans, nestled away on Mount Zion. Can you imagine?
Wow.
Lived on Mount Zion, and threw myself into the study as a little institute called the American Institute for Holy Land Studies. And I studied ancient Near East history. But we weren't just sitting in a library. We were out in the field all the time. Every week, sometimes every day, we're out rummaging around antiquities and ancient archaeological sites and doing real kind of Indiana Jones stuff before there was an Indiana Jones. And I just got the bug. That's the only way I could get over the culture shock anyway. And somewhere along the line, during my first semester studying overseas, somebody explained how Hebrew is taught in the modern state of Israel. I'm amazed a lot of people don't even know that Hebrew is the language of Israel today. A lot of people don't know that.
Right.
But they said, look, if you want to really get into this, study Hebrew. I'm saying, what, the modern language? Yeah, the modern language. It hasn't changed in 2,000 or even 3,000 years. It's the only language in the world that hasn't changed significantly.
So
you learn the modern language and you're dealing with the ancient world. And I said, I'm down. So I enrolled in a little program, actually a pretty big program sponsored by the government of Israel for new immigrants coming in. And we're talking about Jewish immigrants. They come from all over the world, every country, and all different language groups. And the amazing thing is all they care about is what works. Can you imagine if we let that attitude loose in our institutions today? You know, they didn't give grades, for one thing. They weren't interested in grammar and linguistics and all the stuff that we teach over here. They just immerse you totally. From day one, the very first shalom, you got 5 hours a day, 5 days a week, Hebrew. And, yeah, after a few months of that, you're either fluent or in a hospital, one of the two.
And I'm assuming you ended up on the fluent side.
Well,
not the hospital side.
I just got intoxicated by it because I realized I'm learning an ancient yet modern language. And one of the few Americans over there who actually managed to do it. I just threw myself into it. I'm speaking it, living it, dreaming it. And so one day I decided to test myself. This is after just a few months of study. I'm already getting around in conversation in the streets of Tel Aviv and Jerusalem. I hopped on a city bus bound for an annex of the Israel Museum of Jerusalem called the Shrine of the Book, and walked into it, and you got this huge central rotunda built of poured sculpted concrete and this enormous dome and this dim light, and smack in the center, unrolled round the rim of this enormous glass case, is the complete book of the prophet Yeshayahu. We call him Isaiah. 2,000 years old, an ancient scroll. This is one of the Dead Sea Scrolls, and that's the museum that was built to house them. I walked up to this glass case and stared at this parchment. Just a few months ago, I knew nothing. All I knew was shalom. Right? I came to Israel, and they make you that good in a few months. I'm staring at the thing. It would have been chicken scratch just a few months ago. I'm looking at it, and I managed to make out the letters and start reading the thing. And I'll never forget. I found one passage, and it just ripped itself out of the parchment, you know, penetrated into me. And the words read, Kol kore, that means a voice is calling. Bamidbar panu derech Hashem, in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, of God. Yashru ba'araba mesilal Eloheinu. Got all that? I was reading this. And make a pathway in the desert. And I'm reading the Dead Sea Scrolls.
Well, hang on. You left us with that. We got to take a hard break, but, I mean, that's a great place to finish off on. You listen to Jason and JV Beyond Reality Radio. We'll be back after this.
Got this in pocket, gunpowder, I'm gonna use it, intention, I'm feeling mental, gonna make you. got motion, restrained emotion. I've been diving, detour leaning, no reason.
Welcome back to the program. It's Beyond Reality Radio. Tonight we're talking with Dr. Ken Hansen. Website for Dr. Hansen is treasuresintime.org. You should check that out. He's got a number of books to his credit, including one they're going to be chatting about tonight. Well, actually, we'll probably chat about more than one, but The Dead Sea Scrolls, The Untold Story. And Ken, I have to say, you were describing how you kind of developed a love and an interest in all of this. And one of the things you said was that you developed an interest in Western civilization. You went to the cradle of that civilization. And what a lot of people don't understand, when they think about the Holy Land and they think about the history there, they only think about religion. But in truth, that is where most of the ideas that we take for granted were incubated, whether it was through religion or not. It still is the foundation of basically everything we think and do, isn't it?
You are so right on. That's exactly right. It's not just about religion. It's about cultures. It's about civilizations that came forth. Jewish culture, civilization, Western Christian civilization, obviously, and also Islam. Islam is directly rooted in this whole bubbling cauldron that we call the ancient Near East. The world just would not be what it is today if certain things didn't happen exactly when they did.
As you were, first of all, developing a fascination for the Dead Sea Scrolls, you had learned Hebrew. Tell us a little bit about the Hebrew language, because we've already established that it's an ancient language, yet it's virtually unchanged from thousands of years ago.
Yeah, it's just remarkable. There's no language like it on the earth. It's a Semitic language, and it's very similar to Arabic. Jewish and Arabic Islamic culture are really remarkably close. People think, oh, Jews and the Arabs, they just can't get along. My goodness, these are kindred civilizations with kindred languages, in fact. Arabic, Hebrew, going way, way back, thousands and thousands of years, though Hebrew antedates everything in terms of languages that are used today. The language of the Bible, of course, of the books of Moses, it's difficult to know even how far back we can trace it. That's an academic issue like so many, but certainly thousands and thousands of years. And it has had a little bit of evolution over time. I kind of liken it to the difference between Elizabethan Shakespearean English and modern English. There are a few changes, a few these and thous. Hey, if you know modern English, you can probably handle Shakespeare, maybe with a little help, but it's the same language. And that's about the difference between ancient biblical and Dead Sea Scroll Hebrew and modern Hebrew. You live over there, any modern Israeli can pick up the text of the Bible or even the Dead Sea Scrolls and just cuddle up with it like a newspaper. So standing there in that museum, I had this epiphany moment, and I decided I'm going to do something with my acquisition of the language and study all the way to PhD and earn it in Hebrew language and literature, which I accomplished at the University of Texas, Austin, with an all-Israeli faculty. I was such a fanatic, I never spoke a word of English the whole time I was in grad school. And it is still the lingua franca of our Judaic Studies program here in Orlando.
But it's amazing when you realize how little that all the languages out there have changed over time, but just how little that language has really changed. It's truly just mind-blowing.
And there's another reason for that, and that's because the Jewish people were conquered. Their nation was destroyed. They were conquered over and over again. The Romans conquered them, and eventually they had to flee their own land. And we talk about the wandering Jews, and indeed that's true. The Jewish people have wandered all over the world, and they lost their own language in terms of a spoken language. They spoke Arabic, they spoke Yiddish over in Europe, and they only used Hebrew in prayer books, in synagogues, to pray. And it went into sort of a suspended animation as a language for 2,000 years. as the Jews wandered over the face of the earth, and was only revived around the turn of the 20th century. That's another amazing story. Really, one man, basically, was responsible for reviving a dead language. His name was Eliezer ben Yehuda, and he was a European Jew, originally from Russia, came to Palestine and said, we've got to have a common language. And they laughed at him and thought he was nuts. Well, you're going to start... Try speaking Latin today in America and say, we're going to revive Latin as a spoken language and see how far you'll get. And this guy did it with Hebrew, and it became the modern spoken language. He took ancient biblical Hebrew and revived it and started speaking it again.
It's amazing.
Ken, let's talk about the Dead Sea Scrolls, because we're going to find ourselves out of time. There's so much to talk about. Give us the history in a nutshell of what the Dead Sea Scrolls are.
Well, we're talking the middle of the 20th century, the year 1947 to be exact, and we're talking geographically about the lowest spot on the face of the earth. It's the lowest part of the Great Rift Valley. It stretches all the way from Lake Victoria in Africa to the foothills of Mount Hermon in northern Galilee. It's a huge crack in the crust of the earth. In fact, just in the last few days, a new part of it has opened up in Africa. It's a huge crack, and literally the continent is splitting apart. At its lowest spot, it's the lowest place on earth. It's more than 1,200 feet below the level of the Mediterranean Sea. And exactly in that spot, we find a saline salt lake. It's called the Dead Sea. It's the natural border between the modern state of Israel and the kingdom of Jordan, 1,200 feet below sea level. And 1947, we've got a Bedouin shepherd lad wandering around out there with his flock of goats. He's a goat herder. When one of his goats gets missing from the rest, this little kid doesn't know where the goat has gone, and he starts rummaging around through every nook and cranny up and down the western shore of the Dead Sea, poking his head into assorted desert caves, looking for his goat, and doesn't find anything. Starts throwing stones eventually into cave entrances, some of them up in the cliffs. There's a whole rim of chalky marl cliffs on the western flank of the Dead Sea. He hurled stones into one cave entrance after another, big rocks, thinking he'll frighten the animal out into the open. Still, he finds no goat, doesn't scare anything out of a cave, but he hears something inside a cave that sounds like something breaking or cracking. Something's breaking in there. And he hauls himself halfway up the side of the cliff and squeezes through a very narrow cave entrance. And you've got to think of Indiana Jones again. You can't make this up. Squeezes through there and finds himself staring at a whole row of big earthenware pottery jars leaning up against the cave wall. And his stone has impacted one of them. And that was the cracking sound that he heard. He starts prying the lids off of those jars, one after another. And they're all empty, except one. He pries the lid off of one jar, and deep inside is a big bundle of something, all rolled up and covered over with a flaxen sort of cloth material. He doesn't know what it is, just a bundle. Hauls it out of the clay jar. He's really worried about desert ghosts and goblins who inhabit these recesses. So he hightails it out, forgets all about his lost goat, back to his Bedouin campsite. And they pull away the flaxen covers and are confronted by several pieces of crumbling, decaying parchment covered over with the chicken scratch sort of writing they can't read. They don't know what they found. Well, their native tongue is Arabic. And even though it's a sister language to Hebrew, if you know Arabic and you don't know, you can't read it. They didn't know what they found. And this is ancient Hebrew. So they just roll it up again, stuff it into a burlap sack, and leave it dangling from a tent pole. And that's the beginning of the saga of the Dead Sea Scrolls. They wander for weeks through the wilderness of Judea with a burlap sack and the first Dead Sea Scroll. Eventually make it to a little town called Bethlehem. Heard of Bethlehem? And find a little Arab shopkeeper by the name of Kondo. They sell the parchments to Kondo, and then they take off. And now the shopkeeper looks at him, Arab shopkeeper. He can't read him either. And he heads up to Jerusalem and finds an archbishop in the Syrian Orthodox Church. I think it's the one city where all these cultures and religions come together. It's Jerusalem. They can only figure out how to live together, right? And pounds on the door of this monastery, and this archbishop meets him. And now the Arab shopkeeper sells the first Dead Sea Scrolls to the archbishop. The archbishop looks at him, and he can't read them. And eventually, his emissary contacts a Jewish professor in West Jerusalem. This is 1947, and the city is divided, and it's on the brink of Israel's war of independence. There's a big, ugly no-man's land through the middle with landmines, and I've lived there. In fact, one of my buddies lost his leg to one of those landmines, so this was real. And the professor, the Jewish professor, now meets the emissary of the archbishop at a checkpoint between East and West Jerusalem, and he receives into his hands this little snippet of parchment material covered with ancient Hebrew lettering, and he looks at it, he can read it. The first person, he's blown away. This looks old, far older than any other parchment he has ever seen. And that's the beginning of what becomes a 10-year saga of discovery. Some of the scrolls are taken to the United States. They're put on display in the Library of Congress. They try to sell them for $1 million, and nobody buys. In the end, another Israeli professor and political figure and military guy also is in the United States and manages to buy several of these scrolls in the U.S., brings them back to Israel, and the whole saga just evolves over the next 10 years, and we've got a whole library now of ancient documents, 2,000 years old, from the days of Jesus and John the Baptist and the Romans and King Herod, and we got a whole cast of characters, a storyline. We've got entire books unknown to the world until 1947, 1948, It's a phenomenal story.
Well, and the crazy thing is I know some of them actually are being sold through classified ads at one point
they
as well.
They placed a classified ad in the Wall Street Journal back in the U.S. This is the archbishop did this because he couldn't find anybody willing to pay $1 million. In the Middle East, you ask some inflated, ridiculous price, and then you start bargaining. Here in the U.S., we think, well, gee, that's the price. I can't pay that. You don't know how to bargain. You got to live in the old city of Jerusalem to know how to bargain.
Yeah, you haggle.
It's a classified ad in the Wall Street Journal, of all places. And that's when the Israeli professor, he has a buddy who discovers that classified ad. And the professor, his name is Yigael Yadin, and also a military commander in the young fledgling state of Israel, visiting in the U.S. Of course, he's a Middle Easterner. He knows how to bargain. And he manages to buy the first four of these Dead Sea Scrolls, not for $1 million, but $250,000, $250,000, which is quite a chunk of change back in the early 1950s, we're talking.
Yeah. Well,
but he's ecstatic. He brings them back to the fledgling state of Israel, and eventually they build that great rotunda, the Shrine of the Book Museum that I end up walking into years later.
Well, and somehow we lost the ability to haggle. I think that's the key thing in there. All right, so we got to take a break and a lot more to come. You're listening to Jason JV on Beyond Reality Radio. We'll be back after this.
Don't get carried away.
Welcome back to the show. It's Beyond Reality Radio, and the night is already flying by. It's Jason and JV, our guest tonight, Dr. Ken Hansen. We are going to get in a very serious discussion about the Dead Sea Scrolls and other biblical archaeological wonders. And I've got to ask you, Ken, when the Dead Sea Scrolls, first of all, it's hard to understand. This is a collection of not just scrolls. It's a lot of paper, parchment and papyrus fragments. What percentage of the material has actually been able to be read, translated, and understood?
Pretty much all of it at the moment. Bear in mind, we have a number of more or less complete scrolls. Some damaged, but some almost perfect, like that Isaiah scroll that I first stared on. 66 chapters long, beginning to end, complete and entire. And there are a number of other more or less complete scrolls in that great Israeli museum to this day. But then there was another, let's call it the mother of all caves, discovered a few years after the original find. Because when the Bedouin shepherd first found those original scrolls, it was like a mad dash to comb every nook and cranny up and down the western shore of the Dead Sea. I call it the Great Scroll Rush, to see how much more they could find. And one cave in particular was discovered, I'm afraid, not by archaeologists, but again by the Bedouin. It was a race to who could get there first. It was called Cave Number 4. These started out as complete scrolls, but they were buried in the floor of that cave and covered over with sand and pebbles and dust and just left there for 2,000 years. And you can imagine what happened to them during the 2,000 years. They crumbled. So rather than nicely inscribed scrolls, we've got tens upon tens of thousands of little tiny pieces, some of them no bigger than a postage stamp or a thumbnail. And because the Bedouin found it, not the archaeologists, they just started pulling this stuff out of the ground in big handful and stuffed them into their burlap sacks, and off they sped. And eventually, the government of Jordan paid $2.50 for each square inch of material they would turn in. And so the Bedouin started selling these pieces to the government of Jordan. And they housed all of these in the basement of a different museum called the Rockefeller and tried to piece them together over the next 40 years, four long decades. And nobody could even look at them for four decades. And all kinds of speculation arose. What are you hiding in there? Some kind of mystical secrets and so on. It's just the world's biggest jigsaw puzzle. And at this point, we can read virtually every tiny piece of those parchments. But the trouble is, they're all broken. And we don't know where they came from or what order they go in. And what good is a word here and a word there if you can't piece them together? And so that work still goes on. Even within the last few months, a team of Israeli scholars managed to piece together 62 of those tiny pieces to basically reconstruct yet another Dead Sea Scroll. And that's what goes on and continues.
Okay, we don't have time to get into much more here. We've got about 30 seconds. We have to take our top of the hour break, but I do have another question. And when we get back, we're going to get into so much more detail about all of this. But are there more scrolls to be found, in your opinion?
Answer is absolutely maybe.
Absolutely.
We don't know. It's not impossible. Just as we think that everything that could be found has been found and nothing more is out there, something else turns up.
Something else does show up. All right. Our guest is Dr. Ken Hansen, and a lot more to come in the next hour. You're listening to Jason JV, Beyond Reality Radio. We'll be back after this. We'll be right back.
paranormal. Baby. That cannot be explained by scientific methods.
Told of a creature that was 6.5 to 7 feet tall.
The CIA ran secret mind control experiments.
It's a tale of a creature that's been seen by many, but believed by few.
And experts say there have been reported sightings of paranormal activity.
And there was this creature, and it ran down this hill.
They say something was flying over their house, and they have no idea what it was.
How the world's most powerful individuals are actually shape-shifting reptilians.
My scariest ghost hunting experience.
Jason and JV. Jason and JV. Jason and JV.
You want answers? I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle
you
the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
Who it in there? Beyond reality. Radio.
Oh, it's for the wife.
Oh, 20 shekels.
Right.
What?
There you are.
Wait a minute. Well, we're supposed to haggle.
No, no, I've got to get...
What do you mean, no, no, no?
I haven't got time.
Well, give it back, then.
No, 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 I just paid you.
What? Back, then.
No, 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 I just paid you.
What?
Yeah.
This bloke won't haggle.
Won't haggle?
All right.
Do we have to?
Now, look, I want 20 for that.
I just gave you
20. Now, are you telling me that's not worth 20 shekels?
No.
Look at it. Feel the quality. That's none of your goat.
All right, I'll give you 19, then.
No, no, no. Come on, do it properly.
What?
Haggle properly. This isn't worth 19.
You just said it was worth 20.
Oh, dear, oh, dear. Come on, haggle.
All right, I'll give you 10.
That's more like it. 10? Are you trying to insult me? Me with a poor dying grandmother? 10?
All right, I'll give you 11.
Now you're getting it. 11? Did I hear you right? 11? This cost me 12. You want to ruin me?
17?
No, no, no.
Hey, welcome to Beyond Reality Radio. It's Monday on the West, Tuesday on the East. That's Monty Python. You got to throw a little of them in there, especially when we're talking about haggling.
You know, that's the funny thing. Our guest, Dr. Ken Hansen, mentioned that when things are discussed about, you know, buying or selling in the Middle East, it's expected that you'll haggle. And Monty Python did a skit in the movie Life of Brian that addressed that specifically. And as they do so adeptly, they kind of poked fun at whatever culture they were, you know, making a film about. In that case, it was the Middle East. So that was pretty appropriate.
Well, it's funny because younger, of course, we used to hit all the flea markets and stuff, and you go to the flea and you'd walk up to the table and somebody'd say, I want $10 for this. And you never felt proper sitting there saying, I'll give you 8, because you felt like you kind of felt like you were insulting them.
Yeah. Yeah. There's always that insult thing.
But that's not how it is when you get overseas.
Yeah. I have to tell you, and this is my grandmother, who emigrated from Italy in 19, right after World War II with my grandfather. She barely spoke English, very mild mannered woman, you know, just spent her time in the kitchen. That's basically all she did. I went to Italy with her one summer, and suddenly the haggling monster was unleashed. She, you know, on every street corner, she's buying fruit, haggling for everything. I've never seen a woman haggle more than my grandmother did when she was in her native Italy.
It's their version of coupons.
Yeah, it's very true.
My grandmother would do that as well, but it would be more. She'd find every dent can in the grocery store.
Then
she'd
take
every dent
can off.
Yeah, and be like, this is 80 something cents. I'll give you 50. And it was insane.
They know how to do it.
But she saved so much money. She didn't need coupons.
That's right. They knew how to get it done. Welcome back to the program, everybody. It's Beyond Reality Radio, Jason and JV. And our guest tonight is Dr. Ken Hansen. And we've been talking about the Dead Sea Scrolls. And there's so much to cover here. And Ken, I want to kind of back up our story here just a little bit, because there's still some important information for us to understand what these scrolls are. And that is, who wrote them and when were they written?
Yeah, that is quite a question. Who wrote them? And it is a mystery and remains so today. The dominant idea among archaeologists and scholars is that we have an ancient mystical sect, like a cult, known as the Essenes, who were sort of an offshoot group in the ancient world who felt that what was going on in Jerusalem and in the great temple that stood in those days was all wrong, was all defiled. and we need to get away from all of that. We've got a strange, mysterious character who is described over and over in the scrolls, but never given a name. He's just called the Teacher of Righteousness. The Teacher of Righteousness. He's a kind of a mystical character dressed all in white. I think of it as an ancient Obi-Wan Kenobi, honestly. You want to understand the scrolls? Go watch Star Wars. It's the best way to do it. Then you've got good and evil, light and darkness, the force and the dark side, and all this stuff is going on out in the middle of the Judean desert 2,000 years ago. And this teacher of righteousness who believes that Jerusalem is defiled has brought his own flock of disciples out into the middle of nowhere because he's read the prophet Isaiah where it says, prepare the way in the wilderness, in the desert, prepare the way of God. And he takes it literally. And if you're in Jerusalem, if you live there, you know where the desert is. You go due east and you can see it. You stand up on the Mount of Olives. You look, you can even see the Dead Sea shimmering off in the distance and you head straight east out into the desert. And that's what this guy did. He took his flock of disciples out there and basically created an alternate society in the middle of nowhere, eagerly awaiting the Messianic age. Now, was this sect called the Essenes? Personally, I agree with that designation, but nowhere do they call themselves, we are the Essenes. We don't know for sure. I think they're an offshoot, actually, of an even earlier group that I call the Visionaries. And nobody has heard of this group, but this goes way back into biblical times. This is a group of people who felt shunned from the establishment, and even back in the days of King David and King Solomon, they were a priesthood that was shoved aside. And we do read that in the Bible. David appointed two high priests, and one of them was kicked away by Solomon. And they went off and got into tension with what was going on in the regular priesthood. And this group called the Visionaries began to cultivate, believe it or not, paranormal experience. And they began to write down visions and mystical revelations over centuries. And I think that that group of visionaries then evolved into this particular sect out in the Dead Sea looking for the end of the world. And they believed, honestly, that the Messiah was to come any day, that the end of the world would take place at any moment. And they began writing down their paranormal experiences in many of these scrolls. It's unbelievable. It's a whole library we never knew existed.
Now, these experiences, were they communications with the other side that they were being told?
Apparently. Now, the one gripe that I have with modern scholarship, as a scholar myself, is that we're not supposed to get into that. You know, we're just supposed to deal with literature and folklore and mythology, but we never are allowed to ask what these people might have been experiencing. What, were they just fabricating all this stuff? Were they making up the experiences they had with the other side, as you call it? Or were they liars, basically? Or did they really have some kind of experience? We're not supposed to go there. But I think we ought to go there. And when we look at some of what they wrote, clearly something was going on. Something was going on. They produced, for example, my favorite of all of the Dead Sea Scrolls is a text that had to be pieced together from those mountain of fragments. And it was found in one of those caves. It was also found an identical copy on top of a rocky plateau that held out against the Romans. Some may have heard of it. It's called Masada. And it's out there in the middle of nowhere in the desert. And you got two identical copies of this same Dead Sea Scroll. And it's called the Song of Sabbath Sacrifices. It's the oldest extant example of Jewish mysticism, which today we call Kabbalah or Kabbalah. Some people call it Madonnaism. It's Jewish mysticism. This is a mystical text and it describes paranormal encounters. Now, they call these beings angels, but I've got my own translation of snippets of the text right in front of me if you're interested.
Yeah, absolutely.
This is the mystical text. It's called the Song of Sabbath Sacrifices. It's a Dead Sea Scroll. This is not in the Bible. You won't find it anywhere in your Bible. It's an unknown text. And here's what we read. While they are soaring aloft, a murmur of voices is heard, and the lifting of their wings is accompanied by a clamor of joyous song. It is the murmur of angels blessing, get this, the chariot-like throne above the firmament of the cherubim, while they themselves from below the place where the glory dwells go acclaiming in joyous song the splendor of the radiant expanse. Radiant expanse, mystical beings, some kind of interdimensional beings. They call them angels. Or then we have a chariot-like throne. And that became the very center of mystical speculation from ancient times right down to the present day. It's called Merkava, the chariot throne. And it's an amazing thing. Modern Israelis are living right on top of the Bible. And most Israelis are not particularly religious, mind you, but everybody knows the Bible. They know their ancient text. They speak the same language. And incidentally, the Israeli battle tank today, best tank in the world, mind you, it's called the Merkava, and it's named after this mystical chariot throne that we also find in the book of Ezekiel, which a lot of people think it describes a UFO encounter of some kind, a chariot-like throne with wheels on it. It says, and now I'm reading the Dead Sea Scroll, whenever the wheels of that chariot are in motion, angels, these are interdimensional beings of sanctification, dart to and fro all around it, between its glorious wheels, like fiery apparitions. They are most holy spirits, looking like streams of fire in the likeness of burnished metal or of lustrous ware, clothed in luminous garments, an array of wondrous colors, going beside this glorious, wonderful chariot. Think about that.
Wow. Well, we actually have to take a break here, but when we come back, we're going to continue our conversation with Dr. Ken Hansen. Visit his website, treasuresintime.org. One of the books that he's got featured there is Dead Sea Scrolls, The Untold Story. There are many, many other books to his credit, and a lot of work, a lot of research, a lot of fascinating material.
And if you have a question for us or Dr. Ken Hansen, give us a call at 844-687-7669. Again, toll free at 844-687-7669. You're listening to Jason and JV, Beyond Reality Radio. We'll be back after this.
Finally, I figured out what it took a long, long time. Now there's a turnabout made because I'm trying. There's been times all my
All for you. Welcome back to the program. It's Beyond Reality Radio, Jason and JV. Phone number 844-687-7669. We're talking with Dr. Ken Hansen. His website is treasuresintime.org. And Ken, I got to tell you, we already need to schedule you again, because we had a list of topics that we were going to go through with you. And I don't think we've gotten through the first one yet. And each one of these topics could clearly be a whole program unto itself.
Yeah, I think you're right. There's a whole lot to talk about. And, of course, scholars spend their entire lives digging into this stuff. I like to say you cannot make these things up. And, you know, the old adage, truth is stranger than fiction. And ain't it the truth?
We have just a couple minutes here again before we have to go to another break, sadly. But when we talk about the Dead Sea Scrolls, were they history-changing or history-confirming?
That's a good one. They changed history in the sense that a lot of people in the ancient world believed these visions and these revelations, and they honestly believed that they were in the end of days, that the end was near. Personally, I think that a character by the name of John, some people call him John the Baptist, was a member of this ancient sectarian movement. And how do you suppose all of that changed the world? In fact, even Islam may be rooted in a lot of the thinking of this ancient sect. Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, this is a bubbling cauldron that produced all these, not just religions, but cultures that dominate the Western world to this day. Absolutely history-changing in that sense. But in another sense, did the world end? Afraid not. Not yet, anyway.
Well, and of course, there's misconceptions, there's misreadings in all of that. But this is the fundamentals that everything else pretty much just came out of.
Exactly, exactly. And again, you want to understand the scrolls, look at Star Wars. You got these dualities, these unseen forces of good and evil, light and darkness in the world, the force, the dark side. They call themselves, in fact, the Sons of Light. The Sons of Light were the members of this group. And everybody else who was not a member were known as the Sons of Darkness. There's a little bit of Waco thrown in here, too, by the way. It's only us, our little group. We've got all the answers and all the knowledge and all the insight. Only us. Can be dangerous.
Ken, when you started to dig into these texts and you were understanding them, did you come up with the same types of conclusions and understandings that accepted academia had at the time?
Well, I'm trained as a traditional Judaica scholar. I'm a Judaica scholar of the Jewish world. And so we do it right. We do it scientifically. And basically, I do accept the hypothesis that this group was called the Essenes. But within that, there are all kinds of debates and counter debates. There are many who think these were not the Essenes. They were some other group. Maybe they were Zealots, or maybe they were ancient Sadducees and whatnot. And then how do we understand the impact of them? What about Jesus of Nazareth? What was his relationship with all of this? And the scholarly opinion is all over the place, and each of us has our own viewpoint regarding that. So, yes, I accept most of the scholarly opinion, but then I've got my own views as well. And not to mention, as I said, there's a whole angle that scholarship sadly just doesn't get into. What was the experience of the writers? These are paranormal experiences, encounters, and we can't talk about that. We can't speculate what was going on in their heads. Well, no, we just deal with literature, and
well,
that's a shame.
Especially when, of course you just deal with literature, but to understand the people, you need to understand the things that they're writing as well.
You bet, yeah, and it all weaves together.
Yeah, so
experience, what they write down. Were they fabricating this? Were they just making it up? Were they telling tall tales that had come down to them? Or did they have some kind of, call it psychic, call it paranormal encounters? Were there a whole group of people, I call them the visionaries, who were actively cultivating this paranormal experience? Why? Because they were the outsiders. They didn't control the temple. They didn't control Jerusalem. They were shoved aside, and so they began to look for other means of authority, spiritual authority, paranormal encounter. They started to cultivate all of this.
All right. And with that, we're going to take a quick break. A lot more to come. You're listening to Jason and JV, Beyond Reality Radio. We'll be back after this.
Welcome back to the show. It's Beyond Reality Radio with Jason and JV. Our guest tonight, Dr. Ken Hansen. And we're going to quickly run out of time. We're going to get to some phone calls in just a moment, too. So if you've been on hold, please be patient. Ken, at what point did you get the nickname Jerusalem Jones? Because I love it.
Well, actually, a friend of mine dubbed me Jerusalem Jones. I've been going around for years and years giving talks. And, of course, as an author, I go out and do book signings and do talks and presentations and actually tell the story of the Dead Sea Scrolls. We got two stories, actually. We have the story of discovery, and then we have the story of this teacher of righteousness and his group of disciples in the ancient world. But I would tell the story, and one day I put on a fedora, right, that I had found at Universal Studios since I live in Orlando, an Indiana Jones fedora, and started telling the story. Somebody called me Jerusalem Jones, and the name stuck.
that's got to be an honor, though.
Yeah.
It is. It is.
It's perfect.
Love it.
All right, let's jump to the phone lines. This is CJ calling from Rhode Island. Hey, CJ, welcome to the show.
Oh, it's TJ, but that's okay. I love Jason, JV, your great show, wonderful people.
Oh, thank
and
you.
I'm glad for a chance to talk to Dr. Hansen. And I have first comment, really, is when you were mentioning that passage regarding the chariot throne and the luminous, I don't know what you want to call it, appearances around it. That sounded very much like a poetic, primitive description of what occurs many times on the UFO shows I hear, which is one large ship, and then seen from a distance, you would somehow get lots of small luminous objects coming out and circling it and basically dancing around it.
It's funny that you said that, because I thought the same thing when he said that.
Yeah, it reminded me very much of that. But again, it's from a poetic view, from a primitive person's, you know, perspective. And the second one was considering and touching on Gnosticism. Someone like, say, Saturnius of Antioch or Menander, has anybody, given that their view of angelic creation and powers and virtues regarding humanity, has anyone that you know of, or have you yourself done an investigation or a point comparison to see how much of this derives from the theories that were formulated recently and put forward by Zachariah Sitchin regarding the Anunnaki? How far rooted are they in Sumerian religiosity?
A lot of depth there. let's try to take the first question, which was, again...
That was just a comment regarding the chariot throne the way it came across when you were saying it, and it sounded to me very much like a modern-day description of a UFO.
And I got to tell you, it does sound like a modern-day description of a UFO. Again, sadly, we scholars are not supposed to go there. I don't want to be laughed
at. I know, that's why I'm glad you're on the show right
colleague.
Now, because I get a chance to talk to someone of your caliber and present something like this and not have you roll your eyes and say, get this man away, he might have a knife.
Yeah, exactly. And I think it's too bad, because something is going on, I think, beyond physical reality. If all you have is just science and the material world, and you acknowledge nothing else, well, there's a whole lot of human experience that we can't explain. What do you do with all of that?
Especially when science isn't willing to look past what it can see. I'm actually a devotee of the late
psychonaut. Name was McKenna, Terence McKenna, who noted commonalities as a scholar himself all through history between what people record and modern experiences, and we'll call them UFOs. And his idea is that, or was, that the UFO really represents oftentimes a salvational kind of millenarial hope in something beyond our own experience, and that can present itself across time in different ways, as sprites or angels or elves, or my goodness, in the Greek world we had shamans who were in touch with another reality. And we shouldn't just dismiss all of that. What, were all these just liars, or were they really experiencing something? But different cultures experience the phenomena in different ways. Well, and in modern times, we see luminous objects, and we call them UFOs. Now, are these visitors from another planet? That we can't verify. We don't know.
And the other one, though, too, regarding the Anunnaki theories of Zachariah Sitchin, when you have people like Menander and the other Gnostics that go around talking about intermediate powers, virtues, whatever, and how their instrumentality in the creation of humanity, is there anybody you know, or have you ever done some investigative cross-comparative research into Sumerian religious beliefs that may cross over or be a basis for this theosophy?
I have, and I think there is crossover, there is bleed over. In fact, we find the term Anunnaki mentioned in some of this literature, even beyond the Dead Sea Scrolls. There were entire books, and the Dead Sea Scroll sect loved them, books like Jubilees and Enoch that never made it into our Bibles.
Oh, and the last one I would mention
the Pseudepigrapha and the Apocrypha. And Anunnaki are mentioned, along with a mysterious class called the Watchers. And yeah, we find bleed over with the Sumerian mythology. And I think there's something to it. Now, as far as Sitchin himself is concerned, I think we got to be a little bit careful when we start speculating about rogue planets, because we don't want to disconnect our rationality entirely. And I'm not an expert in astrophysics, but I'm told that a rogue planet like that really couldn't function, couldn't be in such an orbit. That I have to leave alone. But in terms of this other bit, the Sumerian part of it, that chunk of it. And you mentioned Gnosticism. All these things bleed together. The concept of intermediaries, intermediary powers that are between humanity and the divine realm. We've kind of lost that in modern society. That's what Terence McKenna said, and what a shame. There used to be shamans in the ancient Greek world who would mediate between the physical world, the material world, and the spiritual world. And now we don't have those kind of individuals, but we do have UFO sightings.
CJ, thank you so much for the phone call. We just don't have enough time to keep going on this particular line of conversation, but we appreciate your comments and your very insightful questions. We only have a few minutes left with you, Ken. I want to ask you about the Copper Scroll, because although part of the Dead Sea Scrolls, it's a bit different. It's got different characteristics, different messages, different language, kind of. Explain what the differences are and why it's important.
Yeah, there was one scroll completely different from all of the others. These scrolls are composed, they're written on parchment material. Actually, it's called vellum. Vellum, which is the skin of kosher animals. And it's the same material used to make Torah scrolls today that we find in synagogues. That's what the Dead Sea Scrolls were composed on, except this one. Only one that was found in a separate cave, this one by the archaeologists. Its contents were pounded into sheets of very pure, highly refined copper. And then one sheet of copper was riveted into the next, and it was high grade of copper. It was malleable. They rolled it into a scroll. It was forgotten about. The cave entrance had fallen in antiquity. And talk about Indiana Jones, Jerusalem Jones. They had to dig through the cave, the collapsed cave entrance, just to get in there. And there they found this copper scroll. They couldn't unroll it. It had oxidized in antiquity. It had gone brittle. They had to saw it into little arcs. Can you imagine? It was the only way to get the thing open and cut through some of the letters in the process. But finally, they got it all out in the open and began to translate and transcribe it. I've looked at it myself in the original Hebrew, and it is amazing. It's an inventory of buried treasure. You could not make this up. Over 200 tons of gold and silver and consecrated artifacts from the sacred temple in Jerusalem with locations where they were buried, in Jerusalem and in the wilderness of Judea. And can you imagine when the archaeologists stumbled upon this find? They dropped everything. They ran out into the desert with metal detectors trying to find it. And to date, not a trace of the treasure has ever come to light. And the questions remain, did somebody find it somewhere along history? But that's a whole lot of gold to find. How come we have no record of any such find? Was the whole thing just a hoax? Was somebody lying? Why inscribe such a thing into sheets of copper? Or is the treasure still out there waiting to be found? And I have a friend of mine, who is an amateur archaeologist in his own right, and he's actually, as we speak, he's searching for it.
Well, physically searching for it?
Yes.
Wow.
he thinks there are clues in the copper scroll that have been misread, and that he thinks he's got an angle on where the actual contents might be, and he's not ruling out the Ark of the Covenant.
Does that have anything to do with the copper scroll project?
Actually, it does. Yes. Yes.
So, Are you talking about Jim Barfield or someone
yes,
else?
Yes, I sure am. I'm talking about Jim. He's a friend of mine.
Okay. Yeah, because his theories are a little bit controversial. But what is going on with the Israeli government and their lack of willingness to allow people to excavate, to see if these things are there?
Yeah, it depends who you talk to. Their point is that you need to be a qualified archaeologist if you're going to do this kind of research, and you need to get an institution behind you, an archaeology department behind you. There are plenty of these already in existence, and much excavation has already been done in the region. So let's just leave it with that. And when it comes to these avant-garde theories, I have some problems with Jim's identifications as well, and he knows that because I'm looking at it in the original Hebrew. I'm not quite seeing what he is. My opinion is, look, what is the problem with digging?
Right.
What do we have to lose?
Right.
Well, exactly.
Right. If Jim is onto something, I'm the first one that'll stand up there and do a song and dance.
Well, you know, you...
But this is controversial stuff, and of course, we're dealing with a minefield in the Middle East, and geopolitics comes into play here in an uncanny way. It's the only part of the world where archaeology and geopolitics on the front pages of the papers are all intertwined.
Ken, let's change the topic just a little bit, although it's related here. It's not hard to believe that there are these things or many other things, treasures, whether they're financial treasures or just archaeological treasures, still buried, still waiting to be discovered. It was just reported in Egypt that another Sphinx was uncovered during a construction project. These things are seemingly lost to history, buried all over the place. But let's talk about the Ark of the Covenant for a second. Do you think, A, there is a literal Ark of the Covenant, and do you think, B, it's still hidden somewhere for us to find?
A, I think there was a literal Ark of the Covenant. I think there was a literal temple. Even that is debated by scholars. And by the way, there's one side in the modern political conflict that denies there even was a Jewish temple in the city of Jerusalem. That's where it gets geopolitical and very incendiary. I think it existed. I think it was there. It was lost in history. It just wasn't mentioned anymore. We don't know exactly what happened to it, but we have an extra-biblical text. We've got the books of Maccabees, which never made it into the Bible, that tell us that the prophet Jeremiah actually took the ark out of the city when it was about to be destroyed by the Babylonians, and he hid it in a cave out in the desert. Cave in the desert. Is it possible that one of those caves, maybe with a fallen entrance, is the resting place of the Ark of the Covenant? We're told that its whereabouts will only be revealed at the end of days. So is it possible? I wouldn't rule anything out. Likely, it's really uncanny that anything survives from antiquity. Including the Dead Sea Scrolls. The question is, why'd they survive at all? And if the Ark were ever found, it would be, of course, it would be the greatest discovery ever made bar none. I'm not holding my breath, to be honest, because things are destroyed in antiquity.
Or either found and pretty much, you know, sold off secretly and so forth.
Yeah, exactly.
What's next in this effort to not only understand what we have here in the form of these Dead Sea Scrolls, but also maybe continue to search for additional answers? What do you see as the next steps, and what would you hope for? Is it just more digging? Is that what we need to do?
We need more excavation. Yep. And we still have fragments that, as we speak, are attempting to be pieced together. I mentioned 62 tiny fragments that were just a few months ago finally released and pieced together. So we still have more to learn. Those particular fragments talked about the festivals of new oil and new wine. These are two festival days that never came down to us in Judaism. What are they about? What do they mean? They also mentioned a solar calendar, which is unusual because in the Jewish world we use a lunar calendar. So it's that kind of thing, not to mention a continuing discussion about the relationship of Jesus with this sect. Did he know about them? Some people think he was one of them. I think John the Baptist was. I don't think Jesus was. So this is the scholarly kind of work that continues to go on, and there are entire conferences, international conferences, that continue on the Dead Sea Scrolls and what do they mean.
All right, we're going to try to squeeze one more question from a caller in here, but we only have a very, very short time here. Randy from Indiana. Hey, you're on the program. You've got just a few seconds here, buddy.
Okay, Ken, did you have to see a show, Garden of the Gods, narrated by Leonard Nimoy, about the Ark, covenant, the Ark of the Covenant?
Your connection isn't too good, but I don't think I saw that one, if I heard you right.
What was the name of the program, Randy?
A Garden of the Gods.
Garden of the
Gods. Garden of the Gods. I've heard of it. I can't recall if I've seen it or not. I've seen a lot of documentaries and so on about the Ark.
If you try to pull up on the internet, it's been deleted by the government, United States government. But it talks about an uncontrollable amount of electricity that it puts off between the two poles.
Interesting.
Actually, the Mythbusters reconstructed an Ark of the Covenant to prove that it could, in fact, generate electricity.
Hey, Randy, thanks for calling. Sorry it was so late in the program. We have to let you go just because we're out of time. And the same thing with you, Ken. We're just out of time, but we're going to have you back.
Yeah, I mean, you got so many great books and so many great topics.
Sounds good. Sounds good. And I want to invite people also to look at my YouTube channel. I have an entire YouTube channel. Just go to YouTube, type in Ken Hansen or Kenneth Hansen. And what I'm doing is creating entire video series, entire like mini TV episodes. I'm doing at the university, but I'm making them available to the public. And I've got things on antiquities, on Jewish culture, on the Dead Sea Scrolls, of course. And even the Holocaust. I'm a Judaica professor. And all this is free. You can go there, you can watch it, you can download them on your own. And I've got well over 1,000 followers now, so check it out and follow.
That's
absolutely
terrific.
Ken, thanks so much for coming and hanging out with us. And we look forward to having you on again at some point soon.
All right, we're going to take a quick break. We'll be back to wrap things up in just a moment. It's Beyond Reality Radio. Thanks again to Dr. Ken Hansen for joining us. Don't forget to visit his website. It's treasuresintime.org. That's treasuresintime.org.
And also look him up on YouTube, like he was saying, because I was checking over to facebook.com/beyondrealityradio and like the Facebook page for us. Then head to beyondrealityradio.com. You can find all the stations we air on across the country. You can download the free smartphone apps. And so much more. If you download the show from iTunes or anywhere else, do us a favor and just rate it for us, because it helps push it forward and makes it easier for people to find. Make sure you tune in tomorrow. And
well, that went fast. That one went really, really fast. You know, sometimes you just don't know what to expect with the guests when you haven't had them on the program before. And many of them we have on, and they can't, they don't talk as much. Therefore, you're constantly trying to get them to talk. And then you have some who have plenty to say, and they just say it. And our guest tonight, Dr. Ken Hansen, had a lot to say. That was great. And we're going to have him back, because it was very interesting. I mean, my list of questions, I checked off one thing on my list of questions. So there's a lot more to talk about with him. Anyway, guys, thank you so much for being here. It was a great show, great way to kick the week off, and appreciate you all hanging around. We had a good crowd in here tonight. It was awesome. People still hanging around, too. But I got to go, I don't know, I'm going to try to walk, but I think it's pouring outside, so I probably won't be able to do that. So I'm not sure what I'm going to do, but either way, I'm going. So have a great night. We'll see you.